Namaste to all of you and welcome to the Bhavan London. I am Anvi and I am deeply honored to be sitting next to one of the greatest scholars of Sanskrit and of several Indian languages, an author and an interpreter par excellence, Dr. Shatavadhani Dr. Ganesh.
Thank you. Sir. Namaskar.
Thank you so much for being with us. Welcome.
It's my pleasure too.
The Bhavan has been proud to host three of his lectures, and I will be talking to Dr. Ganesh on a few aspects related to the same. Ganesh sir, you
Please.
Spoke to us about the Natyashastra.
Of course.
And how it is an amalgamation of the four Vedas, the Chaturvedas.
The beauty is, in Indian tradition, everything in spirit, everything by spirit is taken to the Vedic origin. In spirit, they are all spurting out from the same Vedic wisdom. In dance, in total theater, we have mainly four features: the spoken word, the music, the movement, and the emotions. The spoken word is predominantly seen in the Rig Veda. Rig Veda has maximum number of hymns, and most of the hymns are again used in the other two Vedas, Yajurveda and Samaveda. 90% of Samaveda has only Rig Veda as its literary basis, and it contributes only the tune, the music. In that sense, Rig Veda becomes the bedrock of all literature, all that spoken word found in a theatrical production. And then music, of course, is Samaveda. Every hymn of Samaveda has many layers of music, 4 or 5, sometimes even 7 or 10, like that. And then Yajurveda has a lot of activity. Yajurveda entirely revolves around ritual activity. And in that sense, the movement is represented in Yajurveda. And then the Atharvaveda contains so many things connected with both spiritual and secular sciences, spiritual and secular aspects of life. And emotions, they deal with all. And hence, Rasana Atharvanadapi, all that is connected with Rasa has been extracted from Atharvaveda. This is how the spirit of Veda is reflected in Natyaveda, and it has become universal in nature. Sarvavarniko Vedaha.
That's wonderful. And as we know, the Vedas are the basis for Natyashastra.
Of course.
And as well as they are the bedrock of the Hindu philosophy.
Yes.
So if anybody who is not familiar with the Sanskrit language is such, and if they have to read the Vedas and the Upanishads, what is the most reliable or the most trustworthy source that they can go to?
Beautiful question. Very important, and it's dire need of our times also. At any time, any practicing wise, balanced, and universally rooted Indian mind is better for depending upon these things. Better to go to a translation which has been done, or an interpretation which has been given by an Indian scholar who is very well rooted and very well equipped in universality, magnanimity of Indian tradition, and who can give out the meaning in tune with the modern times, which is comfortable to modern people in a modern idiom. And there are many such translations. I can just suggest works which have been brought out by Sri Ramakrishna Mission, Ramakrishna Math, and Chinmaya Mission, and Adhyatma Prakashakaryalaya. These are some of the centers from which many books on Vedas and Upanishads, Itihasas and Puranas are published. They are highly reliable. And also, for many youngsters to understand Indian culture, I would suggest many publications which have been brought out by the Bhavan itself. For example, Call of the Vedas by Professor Bose is a wonderful book. Though it is selection of some hymns from the Vedas, it's one of the finest collections that I've ever come across. And also many of the books independently published by Bharati Vidya Bhavan, and some of the articles in the Bhavan's journal, and then recently the Preksha journal, which has been doing a lot in this area. These are some of the things which can be relayed upon.
Okay, that's wonderful. I'm sure the audience would really find that very useful. So coming to the Sanskrit poetry that you were speaking about, we dealt with the beauty of Sanskrit poetry and the uniqueness of Sanskrit language. What are the forms of, or what are the literary genres does the language explore?
Almost all. In Sanskrit poetry, we have epics, mm-hmm. we have lyrics, we have songs, we have plays, we have playlets, varieties of plays. A social play belonging to the category of Prakarana, a historical or a mythological play of sublime dimensions, that is Nataka, a harem romance, Natika, an action-packed play essentially based on heroism and violence, that is Vyayoga, a play with connects to pathos, that is Anka, and then a play which is based on inquiry, suspense, and spying, deduction, such things, that is Ihamruga, a farce, Prasana, and a monologue play, one-man show, or one-woman show, one-person show, that is Bhana. Like that, we have many genres since the time of Bharata, and many danceable plays, opera-type plays, they are also available in the name of Uparupakas, and we have many modern plays also. And then we have Muktakas, isolated independent verses, free verses. And then we have verses 10 in number, Dashaka, 5 in number, Panchaka, like that we can extend the length to any extent. And even the novel is available, Katha, and short story, Laghu Katha, like that. Since time immemorial, all these varieties are available. And even the combination of prose and verse, Champu, like that. And modern days, in these years, we have plenty of authors writing, many number of authors writing so many works. My friend Dr. S. Ranganath has extensively written in English on these things, modern Sanskrit writing, post-independent Sanskrit writing, like that.
Mm.
And even today, there are many poets and scholars. Like that, we have all the varieties available. Quality depends upon the writer.
Mm.
And of course, but the variety of theme is really mind-boggling.
It's quite exhaustive.
Yes, exhaustive. Yes.
And are there translations available for them?
Of course. Many works, ancient works have translations.
Hmm.
Nowadays, even the modern works have been given with translations. For example, my friend S. Shankar's poetry is always translated by himself into English. His Devi Danaviyam or Chitra Nishadam, they are with translations like that.
Mm.
And some of them have Hindi translations. Many such North Indian scholars and writers, they provide with the Hindi translations.
Mm. That is wonderful to know.
Mm.
And coming to Sanskrit language itself, it's one of the oldest languages.
Of course.
What do you see its future as?
Of course, it has good future. Mm. When we have sattva, innate capability, innate potential in any language, it will certainly live. And Sanskrit is one such thing. And we have many writers even today writing. More than 1,000 writers are writing in different capabilities, in different faculties, and enriching the literature. And hence, I see a lot of future, not only in creative writing, but also in scholarly pursuits. But the quality may change.
Hmm.
We cannot expect the best quality in all the days. It will vary. So we have good, bad, ugly, everything we have. And that's how a language has to be enriched. More than anything, modern day youngsters who are trained in science and other aspects of modern learning, they are turning to Sanskrit language and literature. They are enriching both Shastra and Kavya, sciences and pure artistic literature. And many of them are not employed in any university, not even in colleges. They are not even teaching Sanskrit for their livelihood. They, just because of their passion, they are passion-driven people, they are learning. Not only learning and reading, that is passive appreciation, they are composing, they are writing. It's a welcoming approach. I see a lot of hope. And one more dimension of Sanskrit should never be forgotten. Even today, Sanskrit is richly living through music and dance. Many of our gifted singers and dancers are all enriching Sanskrit through their active production. Even today we see, and that will continue, Along with it, we have the ritualistic application of Sanskrit. All our pujas, all our homas, havans, yajnas, and even temple traditions, they are all based on Sanskrit. In that way also Sanskrit is living. So also the pursuits in philosophy. In all walks of life, Sanskrit is gradually developing. Along with it, we have the spoken Sanskrit movement started by the renowned Sanskrit Bharati. And through that, lot of work has been done. Simple Sanskrit, simple but grammatically correct Sanskrit, which is accessible to one and all, is being developed there. And hundreds of books have been brought out in this direction. And many number of books from other languages, including English, are being translated into simple and lucid Sanskrit, are published by Sanskrit Bharati. They have a target of publishing 1,000 books in Sanskrit, just based on translations. So such works are going on. We do have a lot of hope.
That was a very interesting point where you talked about English works being translated to Sanskrit.
Yes.
Usually we talk of the other way around.
Yes. Till now, Sanskrit used to provide the basis for translations. Mm. So many works from Sanskrit were being translated to many languages, including English. Now, it is the other way. Sanskrit is accepting so many other things. Mm. Recently, I myself, along with my friend Shashikiran, we translated a Kannada classic novel of Devudu Narasimha Shastri, Mahabrahmana, into Sanskrit.
Mm.
Like that, we have many, many such activities going on.
And that is seen also not just in India, but in a lot of international countries
as
well.
Yes, yes. It's a pan-universal language.
Yeah. Coming to the Ashtavadhanam, the art of Ashtavadhanam, it's a very ancient literary art form and you have been credited with reviving it in Kannada.
Hmm.
So could you talk to us about your journey in learning the art form and how you came in contact with it?
Since my childhood, I had a lot of aspirations to become a poet and had lot of curiosity and enthusiasm in composing verses. And so I started developing on my own. Whatever I learned in my school days, that I used to invest along with my other reading. Though I knew vaguely how the procedure of Ashtavadhanam is and how it will be conducted, I had not actually witnessed it. Unless we actualize it, unless we watch it on the dais, unless we experience a live show, it will not be possible for us to present it completely in all its richness. When I was a boy of 19, not even 19 years completed, I was just a student of engineering. Then it so happened, I came across a Sanskrit Ashtavadhanam organized by Sanskrit Bharati. Having watched that, while the show was going on, I was sitting in the gallery of audience. Then I started mentally composing the answers for all the challenges given there.
Oh, wow.
And I thought I could do it. And I went to one scholar, very great scholar, who was also questioning the person, the Avadhani there. They were all called questioners, Pritchakas, and Avadhani is the performer. That scholar, he became later my guru. I went to him and studied grammar under him, Vidwan N. Ranganath Sharma. And I showed my answers. He really appreciated. Why not you perform? The next day, very next day, I performed in Ashtavadhanam in Kannada. So gradually I picked up and incidentally a great Sanskrit scholar, well versed in Telugu, Kannada and other languages, and was also an Avadhani by name Lanka Krishnamurti, an Andhra person settled in Karnataka, a very pious man, having so many talents. He was a painter, musician, Harikatha Vidwan and many more things. He was introduced to me by one of my friends and he too guided me in that direction. In that way, I started performing, so I had no occasion to look back.
Okay, that is a wonderful story. Did the Ashtavadhanam begin in Sanskrit language?
Yes. As in the case of many other arts and sciences, to all this, Sanskrit is the mother. And Sanskrit provided everything. It provided the bones for stability, flesh and blood for vitality, and soul for spirituality. Everything was provided by Sanskrit. And later, we see the earliest documentation of Avadhana and its proceedings in Kannada.
Okay.
And then in Telugu and Tamil we see. And even the Jain monks of Gujarat, they have developed their own approach towards Savadhanam, which is more based on memory techniques and number games. Well, there are varieties of avadhana, Sangeeta avadhana, Nritya avadhana, Sahitya avadhana, Veda avadhana, and many such avadhanas. But Sahitya avadhana, the art of avadhana revolving around poetry, extempore poetry, is the chief form of avadhana. And that, again, it owes much to Sanskrit. Even today, if a person has to perform either in Telugu or Kannada or Hindi or whatsoever, he has to have a strong grounding in Sanskrit.
Right.
Just like physics and mathematics, they become the backbone of any scientific pursuit, so is Sanskrit and Indian fine arts.
It is wonderful, sir. I'm sure a lot of our audience members would love to know more about you. Where can they find books by you, translations by you?
Many of my performances, Ashtavadhanam and even Shatavadhanam, they are available in the YouTube. And I've already almost 90% of the work is over. Along with my friend Shashi Kiran, we are writing a book on the art and science of Avadhana in English. And it is almost complete. It's a very voluminous book. It may cross beyond 700 pages with all examples. Critically, it has been documented. The historicity, everything is documented there and should be published within 3-4 months.
Okay, definitely looking forward to that, Ganesh sir. Thank you so much for talking with me. I'm sure any amount of time given is not enough to know from you, to learn from you.
With that, we can be satisfied. And people will also be kindled, and people will also be pointed towards that direction.
Yes, they'll be inspired to know more. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Namaste to all.
Namaskar.